Have you ever found yourself in the middle of a crazy situation and then just sort of froze that moment for 1 millisecond and sort of hovered over the situation? Just so you can ask yourself one question. How the heck did I get here? This happened to me rather recently. And as I spiraled deeper down into thought, figure out how I got there, I realized a very fascinating discovery. I realized that there is this very interesting space between an idea and either action or fear, negativity, and all the reasons why that idea won't work. And in that space is where change is forged. And so I'd like to share with you a very interesting adventure that I found myself in the middle of. And I hope that by sharing this with you today, that you too can also realize that you don't have to have a heads up on life to do this sort of thing, or come from a rich or wealthy background. That all you have to have is a little bit of passion and not back out of your idea. So, back to that moment when I got here, I found myself in the middle of Turkey headed to a war zone with 2 large suitcases of medicine, $10,000, and a very basic plan. Well, actually, it wasn't really a plan. I had no plan. My plan was to go look for Syrian refugees on foot and help them myself. And while I was standing there in that room looking at all this medicine, and no, I'm not a doctor, going, oh my gosh, how the heck did I get here? I realized that it was born in the very simple moment of simplicity. When 4 months prior, I had put together a big art exhibit in Laguna, and I was so excited because I raised $14,000 to send to UNICEF. And I was like, yes, I can make a change. When all of a sudden, a month later, I heard that most of that aid, like the aid packages, were getting resold on the black market. So I thought, God, how do you make a difference? You try to do your best, and you can't even do that, if any. And here I am, an artist, an environmental educator, and scraping the hours in between my time to create art, to sell, to raise money, and it's, where is it going? So I thought about it again, and I went, wait a second. I could just go there. There's something called an airplane. I can just buy a ticket and go there myself. And of course, everyone was like, you're crazy. You're going to a war zone. That's crazy. But it's that moment. It's kind of like when you want to work out. There's like this moment where if you quickly put on your shoes and run out the door, you do end up working out. But if you like wait just like a minute, you're like, oh, I have to do laundry. My show might come on and maybe I might want to wait a little and it doesn't happen. So that moment right there, that moment I'm talking about is that space between an idea and action. And in that moment, I quickly bought my plane ticket before I could back out of it. And so I had sort of a plan. My plan was I would pretend I was an artist going to Turkey to learn more about art. Because if I went there with $10,000 and a solo woman traveling alone in a war zone, that's just like a big sign that says, kidnap me. So going and pretending to be this artist that's studying like calligraphy in Turkey, I found myself in that room in Istanbul, and I had just bought my bus ticket for a 17-hour journey down south to Reyhanli, which is the border of Syria. And I was on a hunt for a Syrian refugee. And so I finally found my first family. And this was that moment. This tour guide told me, oh, my neighbors just moved in, actually, and they're really scared. They're not talking to anyone. And I'm like, can I have your address? And he's like, you're going to go there? I'm like, yeah, I actually want to do that. That's what I'm here for. So here I am knocking on the door, and it's that moment of validation. This is like the moment of truth. Now, I don't want to scare them because I don't want them to think I'm this Syrian spy sent out to look for them, but I wanted them to feel comfortable with me. And when this 18-year-old redhead boy opened the door, and here he sees me with my cowboy hat and everything, he's like, what the heck is she doing here? And I'm like, oh, I'm Syrian-American, and my family's from Syria, and I'm studying art and whatever. And I made myself, you know, I made him comfortable with me for him to let me in. When he opened that door and I walked in, the air was so thick in that room I could carve through it. It was the same kind of air that occupies the room. And there was one couch that they had dragged from the dumpster and one little propane tank that they were cooking on. And the family was very sad. You can just tell from their whole demeanor. And they're like, do you understand what happened to us? Now, they have no idea what I'm doing there. Do you understand what happened to us? My son, and then the boy who opened the door cut them off and said, I was in college. I almost finished college. And they pulled me out of college and said, you have to kill people. You have to be in the military. And he's like, I don't want to be in the military. And they pointed guns at my mom and dad and said, if you don't, we're going to kill your family. And so shamefully, he looked at me and he started crying. He's like, I killed two people. And then I ran for my life. And I fled to the border of Turkey. And I called my family and I said, you better run. And so they said, we ran away. And after that, they burned our house down. And here we are now in Turkey trying to start over. And the dad, he just, the whole time this was going on, he was just sort of like, almost like he had been beat to the side of the curb. And he said, I don't even know how we're going to pay rent next month. And I was like, well, actually, I can help you a little bit with that. And I have a little bit of extra money with me. That's from American people that do care about you. And I have a card, too, actually. And I gave them the card. It was from an American person. And it said there, we're thinking about you, and we do care about you. And the woman started crying. And I took her, and I paid her rent. And from that moment on, it was nonstop going down to the border, finding refugees left and right. I could put a face to every blanket, heater, every single a package of milk, blankets. And after I got back from my trip, I felt happy that I went on the trip, but I was a wreck. I didn't leave my house for 2 weeks. In fact, I ripped apart my garden. And as I was kneeling over my garden, there was one image that haunted me over and over again. And the image was a drawing from one of the boys that I had met on my trip, one of the Syrian refugees. And this isn't some first world kid's rendition of a Nintendo game. This is the reality. And so I fast forwarded into the future of this little boy. And what I saw was a boy who would go back to Syria long after the war ended and look for the great grandkids of the person who killed his family, and the cycle of violence would continue. And this is a problem that's plaguing the world right now. It's called cyclical violence. And currently right now in Sierra Leone, this is happening long after the war, except for in the areas where their schools were built. In those areas, there's actually a show of economic growth and peace. So as I fast-forwarded into this, I thought, gosh, I can't get 2 weeks off from work for another year. What am I going to do? And of course, my friends came back, and my friends were telling me, they're like, we want to go too. And what do good friends do? They send each other off to war zones. That's what they do. So I helped them fundraise, and off they went one at a time, coming and going in between that year. And one of my friends came back, and she was punched. Like, Sam, I want to start a nonprofit. I'm like, awesome, do it. So she starts a nonprofit, and under her nonprofit, we were able to fundraise legitimately with tax-deductible letters and all of that stuff. And finally, this time, I had somewhat of a plan. And my plan would be this. Let me go do what I'm good at, which is art this time. And let me do some sort of art therapy program, and something more sustainable, and I'll find a school with teachers, and it starts with the kids. If you want to combat war, you got to start with the kids. So I thought I'd do some professional development workshop for the teachers, and called around, actually contacted different schools, one in Lebanon, one in Jordan, one in Turkey, and I found the one principal was excited. He's like, yes, Sama, please come to our school. We want your therapy program. Please come. And so I was super stoked. I was like, so excited. The community sent me off with a lot of art supplies. The Boys and Girl Scouts made tons of greeting cards to give to the kids, gifts. I was so excited. And I show up in Lebanon, in Tripoli. Again, another war zone. I'm addicted now. And I show up there, and the first thing I see the principal is, I have 2 weeks, let's get started. And he goes, Sama, I need to tell you something. Now, I always hate it when someone says that because you know what's coming next is not very good. And he's like, there is no school. Excuse me, do you know what I've been doing with this one? And there was that idea again in that space where I went, okay, we got to make a school. So I said, well, let's make a school. He's like, yes, let's make a school. I'm like, why is there no school? He's like, because a lot of the nonprofits in this area are pocketing half of the money and charging the kids to go to school. I didn't want to be a part of that. And I just found out 5 days ago they want to charge each kid $300 to go to school. And I was like, well, let's get started then. So Thursday I arrived, Thursday night. Friday, we rented the school building. We hired the buses. He called up all his old teachers and said, look, can you just volunteer until we raise money to give you a salary? And the next day, on Saturday, we opened the school. At first, we had 50 kids. And by the end of the 2 weeks, we actually had 350 kids and 50 kids on the waiting list. And in these 2 weeks were crazy, and a lot happened in these 2 weeks. But one of the things that happened was that I went around to every classroom and did this Drawing Our Dreams program. And it was part of the art therapy. First, you give them a place, then you take ownership. And the way we did that was we let the kids vote on the name of their school. They chose Tuyur al-Amal, which means birds of hope. They chose that name. And we give them ownership in this place, and now they feel comfortable. The next step is to move forward, or the next step is to let them draw their emotions and get it out. Then the third step is to move forward. So in this, in the middle of all this, I went around and the kids were drawing symbols of what they wanted to be when they were older. They wanted to be doctors and physicians and zookeepers and all kinds of things. But something happened on the second day. The very first reason why I was there to begin with is what happened. The kids had a lot to share, and in the mornings and the lunchtime, they'd come and hand me all these drawings, and this little boy handed me a rose that was bleeding, and I said, what is this? And he said, nothing. And that's how kids who've been through a war deal with things. They don't talk about it, they just hand it to you. Another little boy handed me this drawing, and it was nonstop violent drawings after another that I was receiving in that first week. And then we took all of our Drawing Our Dream projects and we painted it on the wall. And this was a way for them to know that when they go back to Syria someday, they're going to rebuild it together as a team. But something happened unexpected that I never thought would happen in the course of those 2 weeks. What happened was that the boy who handed me the rose that was bleeding on the last day handed me another drawing without me soliciting him for a different drawing. He just gave it to me. And it was a rose that wasn't bleeding anymore. The boy who handed me the war and violent drawings, he gave me a violent drawing practically every day, except for the last 3 days, started becoming like him being married. He gave me a drawing of a bird. And the last day, he gave me a drawing of all of him and his friends in the park playing together. And you can see this transformation start to occur. And it was amazing. But the best part was giving them all of the cards that the kids from here gave them. And they were so excited. And when I told them, people around the world care about you, a lot of them started crying. And that meant the world to them. Just showing up somewhere means the world to them. And I handed out all the backpacks and told them, this is from American people, and this is from people from all over the world. And they were so excited about that too. And the journey couldn't have been better. And before I left, I hired an art director who would continue this art therapy with them, and they'd create sustainable projects. And now the mood in the whole school has changed. And it's like a party every week, and they're selling their art now, and they're doing all kinds of cool stuff there. But this story is not about me, and it's not about the school or the kids or how art therapy can affect children of war. It's not about cyclical violence, and it's not even about adventure. This story is about something much greater. It's about the fact that inside of each and every single one of us is a raging potential for change. And for me, I found it in that small space that's buried between an idea and action. Now, I know that sounds extremely cliche because we talk about change like it's the newest diet trend. But change is not buried behind some secret passageway or locked behind the gatekeeping of nonprofits. Change is something that exists within each and every single one of us. And for me, it wasn't just buying a plane ticket. In a simple thought, the act of simplicity. The great philosopher Confucius says that life is very simple. We just insist on making it complicated. It's very simple. If there's a problem, just go, hey, I can just do that, fix it. And so transformation is not this light word that we can just throw around. It's something that you feel. And for me, it's impossible to go and create change without it changing self. So next time you find yourself in the middle of some crazy life-changing situation, ask yourself, how did I get here? And you might find that it was buried in one little simple thought in that millisecond between an idea and action. Thank you.